I'm going to give you a perspective of how it felt just being a student and trying to contribute to our country, really. So, do you know who this person is? Any of you? So, she's a wonderful 15-year-old girl from Norway, and she's on a 42nd week of strike from school because she's fighting for a cause, climate change. And she is by now convinced, I mean, the highest in the EU, that yes, it's a very serious issue and something really needs to be done. And to quote a very famous architect, I can tell you, how accidental are your occurrences really? So just think about how you got here, how many nights you must have spent, the sacrifice and the efforts you must have kept to come here. And all in all, to help your country, or maybe just a handful, but still, that counts. So if you ever thought you were alone, you're really not. The work you'll do today will echo throughout, and honestly, it is going to attract a very large mass of public to you. So, can you see a before and after? What happens really? If you're going to fight for intergenerational equity, if you're going to fight for yourselves really, what are you going to ask for? How are you going to do it with the government? Are you thinking that just the vote is really going to help you? So, ask yourself a bigger question. If you really want to get your hands into the work, how are you going to contribute? Maybe down the line, past generations didn't do their job quite well. Now it's on your hands. And we're really asking, where is that generational equity now? So all our acts speak about it. It's already there in the statutory documents. Okay, we will give intergenerational equity. We will make sure that our youth are safeguarded. Everything has been accounted for. But what it does not ask is how to go about it. What is that mechanism? And if I could ask any of you, what do you think that answer is? Can it really be typed down? Can I really make a statement saying that no, you only deserve this much now, we will think about it later? Is that possible? Not really, right? And what do you think the answer is? It's going to be you. How are you really going to give back and do? Use your mind. You young, beautiful minds are going to really help this country. So. Here's the opportunity. India is predominantly a labor-based economy, right? Europe is a knowledge-based economy. US is an IT-based economy. But we have the strength of age on our side, which is you all. So what does that mean for our cities, really? I'm sure somewhere down the line, you must have found something very inherently beautiful about your city, which you can resonate to. Whether it's your streets, your home, your buildings, your public spaces. There must be surely something about your cities that you can relate to, right? Yeah. Don't you feel that's something worth fighting for? And at your age, definitely. Otherwise, you end up with such circumstances. And you are right in front of your eyes. If you don't take any action, it'll just be taken away from you. So perhaps, maybe my kids will never get to enjoy RA Forest. I stay in Mumbai. So I don't know, it's a very grim circumstance. And it just goes to show that if you're not willing to participate, events like these will continue to keep happening. And not all hope's lost, really. I mean, India has a very bright future ahead of it, and we have to look out for the interests of the public good. So here are some success stories, basically. You know who this man is? This is Afroz Shah. So he's spearheaded the largest cleanup campaign of a beach in the world. It's happening right here in Mumbai and Versova. And quite frankly, his efforts have gone on a global level, and so many interested people have come to assist him in cleaning our beach. This just goes to show that if you're just a man who's cleaning a beach one day and people decide to join you and that movement grows bigger and bigger and bigger, you can accomplish wonders. No effort is really too small, is it? One tap at a time also matters. This man basically fixes any leaking or bad service delivery systems in buildings. So he's an engineer by profession. He just goes around to buildings in his local community and fixes everything he gets. So he's conserving water one tap at a time, basically. You have IIT people also just going out there, building forests in record-setting time, helping villages, groundwater. So many initiatives taken up by youngsters like us. And of course, people's participation will always trump bureaucracy, no matter what the circumstance is. Because when citizens rise, corruption falls automatically. So just to tell you my personal experience, I mean, I come from an architectural background. And quite frankly, by now, I've become an anti-architect after doing planning. In my last year, honestly, I took part in my first ever competition. Honestly, I was from a new college, so I was still like, you know, helping to set up there and making sure that the next batches also have a very good system in place. And amidst all that work, I still took part in this event, which was there. And yeah, so we were given a talk by the OSD of the development plan. And based on that, it really got me thinking, because my motivations were quite aligned to what the event was really talking about. So I made a thesis on how we could use mangroves of Mumbai as, like, you know, making them the true contenders of open space in the city. That was my dissertation. So to say to you that basically a garden will not really satiate your recreational interests. You always run away to another state or a forest to take that natural experience in, right? But that experience is right here in Mumbai. It's in the marshes and the mangroves, which you really know very little about, because everyone thinks the swamps and mucky, muddy grounds, who wants to walk in all that, you know? But if you get to the other side, if ever you are there, there's a very beautiful spectacle you can see every evening. Thing is, salt pans or any water, when the light hits it, it almost looks like a mirror. And trust me, if you're walking along those sort of shorelines, you'll be mesmerized. That experience can't be taken in really in our city, can it? Have any of you even gone to a particular height in our city to see how it looks at any point? Or have you always been on the ground floor wondering what an island city is? Have you ever been connected to the water of the city? Can you name one place here where you've touched the water in Mumbai? Besides Marine Drive, Chowpatty, and your cliches, basically. And eventually, I wrote my paper on open spaces. It was a topic as part of the event, and it got me thinking that we're space deprived in our city. There is very little public open space where citizens can go out and recreate. So what can we really do about that? So it got me thinking. I spent quite a lot of time on it, and thanks to the cross-collaborative, platform which ORF and the MCGM offered us, it really got me thinking to understand how the practical side of it works and what a free thought, if nurtured, what it can lead to. So eventually I just simply said that if you have a hierarchy of open spaces in Mumbai which no one really understands, I mean, how do you differentiate between a playground and a park? A garden is allowed, but you're not allowed to do this in a park. All those rules, and I mean, it's just open space. It's meant for your public interest and recreation. World Health Organization accepts that 4 square meters per capita is the minimum acceptable standard for open space. Okay, minimal. Now in Mumbai's DP, what they've done, they've set a target. Within the next 20 years, that is till the year 2034, we will try reaching 4 square meters per person. Do you understand how little that is, even just to reach as a goal? But I'll tell you what the thing with Mumbai is. Mumbai is the world's most inclusive city. Come what may, day in and day out, I'm going to quote Dr. Jha's paper here. Mumbai has been able to accommodate a population of 500 to 5,000 capita a day. Fresh population incoming into the city. We always complain about the floods, Mumbai's infrastructure, roads, potholes and meteor crashes and everything. But you have to understand that our ULB, the MCGM, is perhaps the most tolerant ULB in the country and in the world. And if you want to talk about inclusivity, every global government is swearing by inclusive practices, but they're not really doing it. They're capping their populations, they're keeping their cities compact and saying, no, we'll stop here. But ours is not the case. Indian cities is a completely different concept. And what did the experience really tell me? So, you're taking an entire urban level challenge on your head. I'm like, my God, how will I solve open space strategies myself? Then I realized, you're never alone, yeah? You have everyone helping you out in this process. It's such a hand-holding and such a knowledgeable process, honestly. And participation with stakeholders, activists, citizens, you have to get everyone in. Realize that you shouldn't really narrow down your field to your own interests, yes? There is every other interest also which will take a piece of the action with you. And of course, it's obviously going to ignite hope in us. I mean, it's a beacon of good governance, and this cross-collaborative effort is just indicating that life for Mumbaikers also changes. You have to understand the implications of your work at the end of it. So for example, the policy comes in to our next development plan and the lives of millions are changed. The amount of mangroves Mumbai has lost is going to be a calamity, honestly. And that is the only natural protection we have against disaster, yes? It's a financial capital is only floating because of mangroves. If those go, I dread to realize what sort of fate our city will have, honestly. After I finished my dissertation, I went to the Navi Mumbai municipality because my work was based there. I showed them my proposal, got them really interested in thinking because this is what they always wanted. They wanted a place in the city where people can personally grow their own saplings and release it back into the city. Which public open space in the world offers you that experience, can you tell me? Where you can sit personally in your public open space garden, plant your own thing, see it grow, and you yourself will release it back out there as a protection and a commitment to your own city. Naturally, they were very interested and they kept it. They will see how they'll look into it. I'm still in talks with them. And also, quite recently, there was one site which was falling prey to a lot of unscrupulous building activities. And as a safeguard to that, I put my proposal forth that it was always a public open space. There's no rights to build here. And I've given that proposal to the government. Alone. No guidance, nothing. Just myself. This is the sort of, I mean, if you're really hungry to fight for it and protect your city, I mean, this is what you can do. Just set out yourself and you have nothing to lose, trust me. There is no credibility, minimal experience. And on top of that, what you're saying is in the best interest of people. What is public open space, according to you all? For me and as per several citizens, it is just open to earth ground, open to sky. Indigenous plants which are of Mumbai, not your exotic species which you can't really relate to. And benches, fountains, all that clutter which is occupying every inch of open space and just sealing it off so you can enjoy. Well, that doesn't really suit our context. You can't really design a garden, in my opinion. Design, for that matter, how much surface are you going to seal off to how much you're going to keep open? Will a child be able to run around? All these micro considerations, how do you really refine them and keep it simple? So I simply said, open to sky, open to earth, and every open space of the city will be only a play of surfaces. Open to particular amount which is sealed for differentially able or a senior citizens group who might not be able to walk on an open to earth surface. In this age of globalization where everything's hit with a culture shock, many of the things which are planned for and designed or built don't suit our socio-cultural context at all. Yes? So you have this wonderful pond which I showed you with the trash floating around. That's in Navi Mumbai. It's a holding pond. You know Navi Mumbai and Mumbai are below sea level, right? So essentially these ponds were made to hold the water and then throw them back out again during high tide and low tide. But what happens to the pond? A planner will come in and say, now I want to make a jogging track around it. I want to make a nice recreation space with a lot of benches and everything around it. But does that really suit our context? No. You saw it in the video. That pond is being used for religious purposes, dumping offerings. That eventually becomes an externality for those who are going for recreation. You see how that contrast is there, where something is designed for and it doesn't really suit our context eventually. It's just an irony to democracy that if you have constitutional right to land or anything, ownership for that matter, and on top of that, a bureaucracy is telling you what are your land uses allowed, what are you permitted to do. And eventually you realize that in all cities, there is a major shortfall of urban planning is that the land use assigned is not matching to what's really happening on ground. That's just showing it's gone in complete reverse. And essentially the solution which many modern day planners are coming up with is purely giving zoning, saying that this is an area, you are free to do whatever you can in this area so long as it matches the descriptions of that zone. That's it.